Hello, this is the DIY Magician on a journey of how to be funny, and I'm here with
Barry Mitchell.
And Barry is very special to me. He's one of my funniest friends. Or he and I was telling Jim Kleefeld that he and Barry are battling it out for my funniest friends here. So Barry's here to answer a few questions. The first question is, who is your comedy inspiration?
Now, are these the same questions you ask everyone else?
Yes, I ask the same five questions.
Okay, all right. So in reality, I'm not as special as you led me to believe.
You could say I saved the best for last.
Oh. We could. It would be inaccurate, but we could, yes. I appreciate you asking me my name, since as best friends you don't remember. okay, comedy inspirations. Carson, Johnny Carson, and Red Skelton, and Dick Van Dyke. And I was trying to think if there was anybody else that came to mind, but those are the first three that immediately came to mind. And so, in essence, I pattern or model my comedy off of them. Someone actually complimented me at a conference I was doing somewhere years ago. I was in my 30s, and they said, you really are like Red Skelton. Nice. And oh gosh, that's a huge compliment. And obviously I'm not, no one could match that, but it was a huge compliment. And I think what they saw in me was heart, that a love for the audience, because I believe that's very important. And then Carson, because he understood the rules of comedy and he applied them, and he had a very gentle spirit, and he had his timing. And by the way, I have notes, because he did tell me the questions in advance, and
that way I get the best information.
Yeah, which is excellent. What you should do, you did the right thing. What was your name again?
The DIY Magician.
Oh, okay, good. It makes me feel better to know that you can't remember your own name either. But Carson's timing was incredible. I mean, he could just sit still and do a look. And so looks are very funny to me. Those little expressions or mugs, or it's just timing is a big deal. And so I'm kind of answering some of your other questions at the same time. But
I will ask them again, though.
That's all right. That's fine. I could actually do them much better.
You could.
Yeah. And Dick Van Dyke, my favorite movie is Chitty Chitty Bang Bang. Dick Van Dyke is so talented, overwhelmingly talented, and just to see his talent level. And in each case, to desire to model them and to say, okay, how would they do it? And then eventually it just becomes who you are inside, because you don't even think about the fact that I'm doing this like Carson would. It just becomes natural because there's such an influence.
I was very good, and that was leading into the next question is, what do you think is funny?
Okay. I think it's funny that when I finished my answer, that your comment was, I was very good. That was very funny. Yeah. Obviously, you're really proud of your interviewing skills. So.
No, you were very good.
Well, when we roll that back, you'll hear him say, but that's okay. I listen better than you.
Yes, you do.
So.
And I pay for it every time.
Yeah. And what was the question again?
What do you think is funny?
Yeah, that was a callback to you saying, memory thing. Okay, what do I think is funny? That was the hardest question for me to even consider in doing this. And I guess I think dry humor is funny. Humor that I would say at least half of the people don't get. And they think you're mad at them, or, gosh, he's kind of rude. And quick humor. I was doing a conference one time with Matt Four. Matt Four is outrageously funny. I mean, and of course he has a style, and his style is very funny, and he's very quick. And so it was really the first time I was able to spend much time with him. And so when he would say something, I was just back with him, and they're always dry, but yet somewhat cutting. Okay, and if you know me, you appreciate that. But if you don't truly know me, it can be dangerous because you're like, "Whoa, there goes my self-esteem."
And no, I know you well enough.
You know how I pick on you, and he said,
"Well, it's like the teacher. If they give you a hard time, that means they like you."
That's probably true. Not in your case.
I figured that. But.
There we go. Yeah, which would be an example. It's to come back and do that. But anyway, what he said really tickled me. He said, "You're like the Don Rickles of magic." Okay, and I thought, "Whoa, that's really nice. I'm comfortable with that." Now, I'm not Don Rickles on stage.
Yes.
That's not my personality on stage, but just in person, I can do that because you don't want 100 people to go, "Gosh, he's a jerk."
Well, see, with Don, it was the other way around. No,
that's true. It was exactly the other way around because they say that he was a really nice guy. You know.
So what does that say about you, Barry? Yeah, I was trained by the best.
That was good. That was good. And then the other thing that I find funny is smart humor. And once again, stuff that not everyone gets. And so that's what I find funny.
I like that. And again, I like that. See, I like that meaning I like what you said. I think we'll clarify that from the rewinding back in there. Anyways, dude.
See? Editing makes you look like this.
No, this is going to be straight through. No editing on this, so that's good. I might add words and comments, but no editing. So
me picking my nose is not good at this point.
That would be up to you. So
my friend Tim Sonnefeld, when a family member passed away, I went over to the funeral, and his nephew was there, and a young little fella, and he was standing around. He was so uncomfortable in a suit and standing in a funeral, and he looked up and he said, "Boy, I wish I could pick my nose." It's because, you know, his parents had told him, "Do not pick your nose." His timing, his delivery, it was so incredible. And I can horribly to say, it was my favorite part of the funeral. And I mentioned it to Tim a lot just the other day, as a matter of fact. So picking your nose can be funny. Did you ask the third question yet?
Because I lost. No, I haven't. But see, you actually are starting to work that question already. But I'm going to, because you had an anecdotal story. But I want to ask you, what was your favorite?
Anecdotal. Very smart.
Big words. I've been trained by the best here, and
that's like four. That's four syllables or something like that. Very smart. I'm sorry. Go ahead.
No, I appreciate that. The question is, what was the most what was the funniest moment that you've had that was unscripted as a performer?
Okay, and that one was very easy for me to answer because there's one that really stands out. And I've had several good moments, and I'm very blessed. But I'm also pretty old, and I've done this for over 30 years, so hopefully you've had good moments.
Well, I want to tell you, you're not that old, number one. And two, you've been performing for a long time, but you started very young. So we're only a few years apart, so you're not that old.
Yeah, well, thank goodness I don't look as old as you.
That's true.
That's right. But I was doing the theater show. I was an opening act for T.G. Shepherd. T.G. Shepherd, I always have to say who that was. He was a country music star. He's still alive. Country music star, somewhat of a legend of country music. If you're not a country music star and an older classic country music star, you go, who's he? But anyway, I was his opening act for a year. And so we had usually 1,000, 1,500 people. And we had a group come in that was Harley, you know, motorcycle, okay. Motorcycle guys, which, you know, motorcycle guys, gang or whatever. No, they're pretty much doctors and lawyers because gang members can't afford a Harley. But so there was a good group. They were very rowdy and having a good time. And I brought one of them up on stage, and in the routine, he's seated, and I'm, you know, joking with him and everything. And so the first thing he does is he pulls out this really big knife and pulls it open and does this. Okay. And pause. I looked at him, and I reached into my table, and I pulled out a .22.
Oh.
And I said, they told me you guys were going to be here. And that was it. I mean, they went nuts. They went nuts. And I, you know, just, it was a very Johnny Carson moment. And is your battery going out?
It might be. I hope not. Let's make this fast. It's looking pretty low there. So yeah, well, it might be a two-parter.
Okay. But anyway, I had a gun in my bag, and it was there for later on in the show where I would do a trick, and then I would look at the audience and say, "Does anyone here know how I did that?" And then, anybody else?
Oh.
So it's a very old gag, which sadly you can no longer do.
No, that's too PC now.
Yeah, that's not good. But very funny moment, because I knew this is the opportunity to use that, as opposed to, it wouldn't have been near as funny later on. So that was my favorite funny moment.
Well, with the battery, I think there's a little story there, but we'll talk about that little personal story there. But
we'll find out if it's actually recorded. Yeah.
The thing is, we're going to get a little more difficult, I think, and ask what makes you funny.
I'm glad you asked. Yeah. Actually, and I've got some notes right here. And the nice thing about having notes is the number one thing that makes me funny is I have a script. So I've already planned in advance what should be funny. And hopefully I was correct in that planning.
Yes, you were.
Well, I mean, but in general, in front of an audience, hopefully I was correct in the planning. And if I wasn't, I can tweak it. But because I've done it so long and I was prepared with what I wanted to say, I had the ability to go off of what I said because of watching. And watching is the thing I have here, is pay attention. For example, when you were setting up before we began, I saw the microphone, and my first thought was, are you planning on doing some dusting? Okay, so you're always paying attention. What they do not know is that the stand that you're using, and you may even want to get a shot of it on your videos.
I have a video on it.
Okay, on the stand? Yeah.
Oh, yeah. I'm sorry. I probably should talk to the mic. I have a video that I've posted. Yes, but I will get a picture of the stand for you.
That's good. Well, and the reason being is because on one side it has a little sign that says this is made from recycled stuff, and on the other side it has, you're shooting me the finger because you're using a little finger hook to hold your clipboard, and there's a reason why that's recycled. Most people wouldn't allow that in their home, but thankfully you have stuff, used stuff. So pay attention to everything. So while we're sitting here and you're checking the battery, it would look seamless if we change locations.
That would look seamless. Yes.
Seamless. Yes. So paying attention, I think, is the biggest thing. I didn't really pick my nose. I kind of moved my nose to one side.
It was a scratch, not a pick? Is that what you're saying?
Pick. Thank you. Appreciate you noticing that. Paying attention, I think, is what makes comedians funny. Okay, that hands down is it. Okay, feather dust.
Well, you got it all written down. I want to tell you that you are probably the most prepared entertainer that I've ever seen. Barry will actually spend hours upon hours upon hours of time beforehand getting it right, and then when he's getting to the stage, spends every last second making sure that everything is perfect, and that is one of the things I respect about you. I want to tell you that. So,
well, that's very nice.
I didn't mean to embarrass you. I'm sorry. You know.
No, well, I don't think you could, but thank you. I believe that's part of my job. We get paid rather well, considering how little we do. So the most important thing I do is to be prepared, and you don't always achieve that, and I'm not always prepared enough by my standards. But yes, I think scripting's important. I feel very simply that the difference between an amateur and a professional is a script. I think that's the difference. So,
I also wanted to say that be prepared is something that I think you learned at an early age because you are an Eagle Scout. And I didn't say was an Eagle Scout. You are an Eagle Scout. And that's another thing that I respect about you. And that's one of the mottos of Boy Scouts is be prepared. Is that not correct?
That is correct. And yes, that's one of the proudest moments of my life, to be able to say that I'm an Eagle Scout, because it is an accomplishment.
It is.
Scouting isn't as isn't as respected today as it was years ago, and that is that's a bad, bad thing, because it should be, and it is a this is a horrible thing to say, but I'm told that I am the king of humble. It is a big accomplishment. So yes, that's very important to me. Thank you for saying that.
You're welcome.
Now let's get away from my
humility. Let's be prepared. That's right. Yeah.
Be prepared. Let's get away from my humility for a moment and say that another part to that question or answer is it's not about me. It's about the audience. I think the audience is more important. It took years for me to realize that and to realize, you know, everything is about, oh, me doing this trick and me showing off, because in most cases, many magicians are collectors. We're collectors of toys, and we don't perform the toys. We go, oh, look at my new toy. You want to see another trick? Look at my new toy, or look at my little move I'm doing here. And I think we all do that in the beginning. And at some point in my career, I realized that this is what I like, and it doesn't matter what I like. I mean, I may do something in the show that's not my preference, but what I believe will fit with these people, because those are the ones paying me, and that's important. So it's not about me, it's about them. For me personally, one of the things that does that is my dialect. And the way that on stage, I'm like, I'm from East Tennessee. I'm told that I speak funny.
No. No, no.
Now, in my opinion, I have no accent at all. I'm speaking, hopefully, understandably. But on stage, I do put on a little more country.
No, no.
Yes. And here's why that's important. If country and southern dialect, many people in the world consider you stupid. And I'm okay if you consider me stupid.
But you are not, but yes.
I hope I'm not. No. But if you consider me stupid, you're going to laugh at me and have fun with me, which is much more important. I'm totally okay, because when the thing's over, somebody in that room is going to hand me a check. Mm-hmm. And so if I was funny because of the way I talked and I stressed an I when I said white.
Or the child.
The child, you know, if it made you laugh, I did my job. So dialect and really experience. So you get funnier with time if you pay attention to the rules. There are certain rules of comedy, and if you know those rules and understand them and apply them, that's it. Many people do not know the rules. Little things, that how to write a joke, how to craft it, where to put the punchline, how to word the sentence so that the punchline is, in many cases, the last words, the unexpected. So if you know the rules, I think that's what makes you funny.
And this is the good thing about Barry is he is so prepared. He combined the two questions together because you knew him ahead of time, and that's good, because he transitioned from what makes him funny to, and maybe he can elaborate on what it takes to be funny. Because the first thing you're going to say is you've already stepped on that or touched on that. So, but what can you elaborate? What does it take to be funny?
Yes, I think the three rules of what it takes to be funny is timing, and a spouse with a real job.
And health insurance.
Yeah, a spouse with a good enough job to have health insurance. That's, and actually, I did that joke wrong. The line or the question is, how do you make a living doing comedy? Timing, and a spouse with a real job is the line, because it's the rule of three. The punchline is the unexpected. You lead them down the garden path and then turn on the sprinklers. You have set up a pattern of one, two, you know, timing, two things that we go, oh, he's going to say timing, location, but it's timing, and so that you follow the rules. That's, in my opinion, what it takes.
That's what it takes to be funny. In fact, you are the first in this series to mention the rule of threes, and that's an official handshake on that. So that's good. I like that. So, but I'm going to give you a bonus. Are there any parting words that you'd like to give?
A bonus.
A bonus round.
Not written down.
No, that's correct. It's the Barry Mitchell bonus question. So.
Bonus question, which I was not prepared.
No. The bonus question is there anything else that you would like to leave with?
Okay. People will not remember what you do. People will not remember what you say. But people will always remember the way you make them feel. So if you can touch their heart, make them feel good emotionally, you are a successful speaker.
Thank you very much. I appreciate it, Barry. And of course, this is the DIY Magician on the road to find out how to be funny. Thank you again. We'll see you next time. If you enjoyed that video on how to be funny, then you can go to the YouTube channel called The DIY Magician and sign up for further funny videos. If you want to follow The DIY Magician, you can go to Facebook. And the Facebook page or group is The DIY Magician. Now, if you are a professional entertainer, we have a special page just for you called DIY Magic Facebook group. So come on along and join the journey on how to be funny. This is the DIY Magician. Until next time.